Please come in, please come in. Don't be shy.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for choosing to spend your morning with us at Creative Tensions. Come on in. Don't be shy. You can pick any of these four quadrants. Don't be shy to come close. We are all people. Yes. Hi. Hi.
And I'm going to ask you to keep that little runway that's in the center of the room open. Just the runway is open, but other four quadrants are all yours to be in. Perfect.
Well, it's so good to see all of you today. My name's Anna Silverstein, and I and my colleague Roshi Gavecci over there come from a company called IDEO. We've been working with Sundance on this collaboration, Creative Tensions, for a couple years now. And IDEO is a design company, and our mission in the world is to create positive and disproportionate impact in the world through design. And the way we do that is by putting people first. So when we work with organizations across all sectors and industries, we make sure that the work we do for them is grounded in the stories and experiences of real people, the people we're designing for. So because of that, listening and finding new ways to hear people's stories becomes really important to us. And that's sort of what led us to our collaboration with Sundance. We met Philip and Christopher from the Sundance Theater Program a couple years ago, and we were just kind of looking for a way to work together. And we sort of stumbled on this format, which you'll experience, that lets people talk about pretty complex topics in a way that sparks curiosity and celebrates nuance and leaves people open to the possibility of changing their mind. So I don't want to give too much away, and I'm going to turn it over to the host of this morning, Philip Hinberg.
Thanks so much. So for those of you who don't know me, I'm Philip Hinberg. I'm one of the senior leadership of the Sundance Institute, and my job is that of artistic director of the Sundance Institute Theater Program. Like the feature film program and the film music program, the native program, and the documentary program, what we do is we conspire to create remarkable environments where theater artists, in our case, can come together and create new work, hopefully fail spectacularly as they work toward the best possible ideals of what they want to say and how they want to communicate it. We work with playwrights, directors, performance artists, actors, composers, choreographers, and we have about six labs that happen each year. We have a lab in our home, which is Sundance, Utah, down the road, for theater makers. We have a lab happening right now in Wyoming, in the northeastern corner, called UCross Wyoming, which is a lab for composers and playwrights just to write. We had a big international lab last year in Marrakesh, Morocco, for Americans and Middle East, North African artists. And we're planning in May to be going to Berlin to work with Syrian exiled theater makers who are in the European Union. Along with our pals at IDEO, we crafted this event, as Anna said, because we work all the time with artists who are dealing with creative tensions, and we're in that process and very much inside of it. And we also are interested in audiences being participatory as opposed to just sitting in chairs and listening to talking heads talk about a subject. So you really are all very, very much a part of what's going to happen now. And the topic we've decided to work on today is empathy, which is, of course, very, very much in the news. Before I was a theater director and a sometimes writer, I was a doctor of Chinese medicine and learned early on that where one places those beautiful needles was actually less important than the stories that my patients told me. In the medical profession, I learned that very, very often patients, clients are not really heard. And that you may have a diagnosis or an idea of how to treat somebody, but if you became really attuned to what their story was, what they were trying to tell you, then you could improvise in a certain kind of way and create a kind of healing plan that was very, very different than what you might have set out to do to begin with. So we're here today to listen and to hopefully, as we hear people speak, our minds get opened, our minds might get shifted, our minds might get changed, and you can then change where you are in the room based on what you're listening to. We're very fortunate to have with us two remarkable, what we call protagonists, who are going to come join us. I want to introduce to you Anand Giridharas and Gael Garcia Bernal. Yeah, I'm going to have you come to the center of the room. I'm going to have these guys stand in that runway, just sort of in the center. And let me explain what this looks like, and then I'm going to introduce these guys a little bit more. But to begin with, I want to do a little practice here. So this room is set up where the center line is sort of what we call neutral. In other words, you don't have much of an opinion. And I'm going to give you two choices, or what we call tensions, and they'll also will appear on these two monitors. And without thinking a whole lot about it, just from your gut, I'm going to ask you to move in the room to what resonates more with you. There's no right or wrong answer, obviously. The only rule I would ask is you try not to hang out in the center so much. And try to make, I mean, if you hang out in the center, I won't judge you too much. But, so let me give you a kind of example. If I were to say to these two guys, and this is not, this is just theoretical. If you prefer marijuana or magic mushrooms, where would you go? Magic mushrooms to your left. Okay, there we go. So, right now, we know where they stand on that. So, let me say a little bit about these guys. I feel like I just met them today, but I feel like I know them a bit because Anand, in the last two or three weeks, I've spent most of my waking hours following you on Twitter. I know. It's been incredibly stressful. And also reposting you constantly as well. And if you don't follow him on Twitter, it's a cool idea to do so. And Gael, I didn't have a smart TV until about a month ago. And so now I was binging on Mozart in the Jungle. So in a funny way, I feel like you've been in my living room day after day after day after day. I'm so glad you're both here. For those of you who don't know, I'm going to introduce you so we actually can know a little bit more about you. Anand is an author, and most recently his book, The True American, Murder and Mercy in Texas, which is the story of a Muslim immigrant's campaign to spare someone, a white supremacist from death row who had tried to kill him. And it has recently been an option for a film to be directed by... To be announced very soon. Okay, good. I'm glad I didn't say anything. But you might recognize Anand. He's been many, many times on television and radio, and he's done an incredible TED Talk about this very, very topic. He's on Morning Joe. He's been on NPR. He's been on MSNBC, CNN. So he's prolific and around and really worth reading and knowing about. And then Gael Garcia Bernal, as we probably know, is an actor and a director and a producer. And some of his films include Bad Education, The Motorcycle Diaries, and Babel, and of course, Mozart in the Jungle, for which he won Best Actor Golden Globe in 2016. And as I read, you are either preparing to do, or your film of Z is gonna be released soon? To be announced. Okay. So let's get down to this. Okay. I'm gonna do a practice round. Are we all ready? We're all gonna move, and here it is. If I were a film, I'd be World Cinema Discovery, an animated short. If I were a film, I'd be World Cinema Discovery, an animated short. Do our protagonists have their mics? There we go. Can you give one to Gael and one to Anand? Okay, so both these guys are World Cinema Discovery. Do you, Anand, want to say just a few words about why that and not the other?
Short is not as good as a long movie, so that's one reason. I'm also not very tall, so I don't need any more short in my life. I'm from parents from one country, grew up in this country, lived in a third country when I was a child, and so for me, the world feels like home and always should be.
Cool.
I like more this World Cinema Discovery from the perspective that I started to see films all my life, because I never saw such a thing as a foreign film. Mm-hmm. I always just saw films from the world. So this one fits very well, even though I hate the category of world music, for example, or stuff like that that just puts everything together as if it was the same, you know? And
like the Starbucks CDs.
Like, exactly. I hate that. But if I take, you know, like, very rationally and kind of like you go to the semiotics of world cinema discovery. I like that. I like that that
cool.
name more than short animation.
So just to balance that out for a second, will someone here talk about why, especially on this side, why animated short really resonated with them? Does someone have a? Yeah, in the plaid shirt.
Animated shorts allow for a lot of creativity just because of the medium of animation. You can do so many things with animation that you just can't do with live action. I think that shorts are a lot more consumable than feature-length films. They're a lot easier to watch and enjoy, and you don't really have to... You have to make every part of a short good. If you want to make a feature-length film good, you have to have three great scenes and no bad ones. But an animated short, you have to make the whole thing good. So that's why I picked animated short.
Cool. Anyone else on that side want to add why? Yes, up front here. There's a mic right here coming to you.
Animated shorts tend to be so personal to the creators and their ideology. So it's almost like diving into a little bit of their world as well. So it's a little bit more personal.
Cool. Cool ideas. Okay, come back to the center for a second, and let's go on with empathy now, now that we've done our little practice. Okay, film and theater are at their best when they unite us, disrupt us. Film and theater are at their best when they unite us. Oh, am I in the wrong place?
My computer's going crazy.
Am I in the wrong place, Christopher? All right, so film and theater, unite us, disrupt us. Well, everyone from World Cinema went to the other side. Okay, so those people, let's actually start with where are our... Wow, you guys are always in the same place together again. This is interesting. Gael, why disrupt us?
Because the time for films to say and to tell certainties is long gone. I think it is time for films to open up possibilities. To raise the questions, even though it sounds like a commonplace thing, that you know, it is important to do a for films to do a Brechtian sort of approach as well, to bring in a problem and make the audience responsible for carrying that problem and inviting them to that problem, and therefore that, in a way, unites. I think
the disruption ends up uniting us.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, and I think the in the order it comes first disrupt and then it unites, I think.
I forgot to mention one thing. If when the speaker is speaking, he says something that is like, oh, and you want to move closer to that side, or in fact, if it makes you feel the opposite and you want to move, you should feel free to move. That's part of what's happening here. So it's not that they're trying to convince you, but it may be an idea that you hadn't thought of. Anand, why disruption?
I think so much of our education and training is actually trying to unite us. We read the Constitution and we all study the same books growing up, and I think most people's lives are more in a rut than they wish they were, and they think the same thing. No one imagines that for their life when they're 18, but by the time you get to a certain age, you kind of think the same things, and your friends all think the same things, and you go to the same kinds of coffee shops, and you're limited. And when you pay 10 or 15 or soon like $40 to go to a movie, it just feels like that's a really rare chance to get thrown on your butt and to maybe be displaced. And I deeply agree that the reason I'm here and not there is once that happens, once I see that the duck hunting Trump voter, once I see something in that really great movie that makes me understand something about them that I didn't before, the second thing that's gonna happen is that. But I think this has to happen first.
Interesting. Can I ask someone on the other side of the room that's way over there, maybe, that went to uniting, why they chose that? Maybe. Yeah, Cooper.
Guilty talking in this room. I'm the director of the festival, so I see lots of films, and I watch audiences a lot, and I found that especially in the 90s, we had lots of disruption. All the movies ended on, there's the problem, now what are you gonna do? Is come back to, I'm all about the happy ending. And so it's really the uniting part is when you show us all the problems, then you show us a solution I'm working hard here to get these people on my side. when you show the solution, it's the uniting that is really the magic, because people just walk away from disruption sometimes with nothing. It makes them uncomfortable. I've seen audiences here very uncomfortable, and they just walk away. Even the Al Gore doc, he showed solutions. So you weren't just living in a poisoned world. He showed you solutions at the end, and that united us.
So I think what we're really talking about is process here, you know, how long it takes and how it takes to get us to a certain place. I think there seems to be a sense that uniting in some way, shape, or form feels like a good idea, but disruption along the way may or may not be. Okay, cool. Next one, empathy. Empathy is a cultivated practice. Empathy is a gut reaction. Empathy is a cultivated practice. Empathy is a gut reaction. Okay, so more people are on this side. Well, people are in the center. Okay, let's just ask them in the center. You right in the front. Can you tell us why you can't choose one or the other?
Yeah, I honestly just don't know. Like, I think it is a cultivated practice over time. Like, you can become more empathetic when you know more about a subject or about the problem that's going on, but for some people, it's also gut-wrenching right when it happens. Like, if a disaster happens somewhere, like, you could be empathetic to that right when it happens, and it doesn't take a long practice to become empathetic for it. So that's why I'm, like, teetering on either side. I would like to know what other people think to try to sway me to either side of this.
So, Anand, do you want to talk about why
I'm trying to win over the swing voter over here.
Yeah.
I think, you know, when you see someone crying and you say, oh, I'm so sorry, or someone has a loss, and you go, that to me doesn't actually feel, we often use the word empathy for that, but that's not what I actually take it to mean. And I'm speaking as someone who writes and thinks about it in a professional context maybe first. It's very easy to, you know, scrunch your face when someone else seems sad, and quite an important thing to do in many situations. But there's a totally different thing in work, and maybe it's the same in acting, which is why we keep sticking together, that I wrote about a white supremacist in the book you mentioned. And is a white supremacist who was very poorly educated, who was a murderer, and had never left Dallas, Texas. So, except for the murderer thing, we had nothing in common. No, just kidding. And so, it wasn't that I had a gut reaction of understanding this guy. If I had to rely on that, I would never have been able to write the book. It took me a really long time thinking, reading, going over, doing new drafts. I mean, even rewriting myself to understand. And the way I did it, the cultivated practice in my case, is trying to not treat him as a whole with whom I have no connection, but trying to break him down into blocks with whom I may have connection. So if I get rid of the white supremacy thing, but say, have you ever felt you were in a situation where you used to be somebody and now you're treated a little more like everybody else? Yeah, we've all had that. It may be a nightclub, and if you can break someone down like that, you often have links to their building blocks, even if you don't have a link to their kind of being.
Cool. Do you want to add to that, Kyle?
Yes, I mean, this word is perhaps the only reason why I still keep on acting.
Which word?
Empathy.
Empathy.
Yeah, because I've always ended up in a situation, you know, I'm sure we've all experienced this, but in this kind of existentialist kind of moments of like, why am I doing what I'm doing? What the hell? What is this? You know, this is not worth it or whatever. And I've always defended and kind of come to terms as well with the fact that acting is a work of empathy. And it is an interesting and an amazing way of cultivating that empathy and finding out different ways of doing it. If you're gonna interpret the character of a person that killed someone, well, it's not, I don't identify with a person, I've never done it, not even close, but I can only empathize emotionally with what that person went through or the motivations, even if there's no motivations at all, even if, you know, like whatever it is, I wanna discover it. So it is the purpose of me working as an actor, but also doing films, producing films, is through empathy. It's actually asking the questions and asking them from a place where I initially, my gut reaction is not necessarily close to that. It's on the contrary, I have to work on it and I have to cultivated in a way. Yeah.
Cool. So we haven't looked into anyone here that feels on the other side from what these two gentlemen just said, that it's really from your gut. I'd love to hear someone say, why do you feel that in order to be empathetic, you need to just sort of be, yeah.
The reason that I'm close to the middle because I think it takes time. I don't think a gut reaction, just because it's a gut reaction doesn't mean you're instantly going to feel what someone else is feeling, but I don't think you can think your way to feeling for someone. I don't think it's like purely intellectual. I think a lot of times if you do take the time to get to know someone, there's like a moment that you have where you hear something about their childhood, hear something about their background, and you see, oh, like now I get it. And I think there's like a shift when you can kind of learn something about someone. So that's why I thought of a gut reaction, because it's not necessarily gonna happen the first time you interact with them, but I think there is like a moment where you just kind of get a shift and have a new understanding of someone.
So it feels like it's almost like your emotional makeup allows you to do that in a certain sense. I mean, if I were to say to all of you, rage, I would imagine that most people think that rage is pretty much a gut reaction. Yeah, right. But empathy somehow carries with it another kind of process, whether or not you're open to it immediately or not. Okay, cool. All right. I mostly want my leaders to show grace, resolve. I mostly want my leaders to show grace, resolve. Oh, this is interesting. I'm surprised.
I know, we separated.
Well, first of all, they separated. It breaks my heart. The bromance is over. So grace. Who wants to talk about grace in the audience? Anyone want to talk about grace, why that takes? Yes.
I just feel like grace is a state of empathy, like being graceful, like the sense that I took the word grace off, it's the one of benevolence and compassion and tolerance. So I want my leader to be tolerant and compassionate, and therefore he's graceful. So he will resolve things gracefully, because you can you can resolve things violently, with anger, with fear, but if you have grace, I feel like you does make the world better.
So Anand, what makes you feel a little shy about the grace thing? What turns you off?
I'm torn, because I mean, I think we just had an American president who just left, who is probably best captured by that word, and I love him probably because of that word more than anything. But I do think that the grace also for me feels like part of what annoyed me about President Obama, and the only time he really annoyed me was right at the end, when I felt like, from my point of view, this country was really going to a very dark place. I felt the grace was too much. And so I feel it's a value that's a limited value, that sometimes prevents you from just being fierce and being truthful. And so I guess I feel at this moment that I'm in, I want, there's someone with bad resolve running my country. I want people with good resolve to meet it, and I'm not sure this is an adequate weapon for where I feel I am right now.
So you just moved across the room. I'd love to know what made you move. What was it that was new?
I at first thought I want someone with grace, because I agree that we can only lead if we have empathy and we care. And that takes a certain amount of grace. It takes a certain amount of understanding and putting your own views aside to lead with grace. But I couldn't agree more. As I look at this country right now, as I look at all of the movies we've seen here at Sundance, mm-hmm. grace isn't enough. We need action. And I think for the first time ever, I've been going to this festival for over 12 years and thinking, yeah, that was a good film. You know, that was really important. And this year, because of so many events that are happening in our world, for the first time myself and many of my friends are saying, okay, it's not enough just to watch it, it's time to do something.
Wow.
Gail?
I'm very surprised that grace is not considered an action. I mean, I'm. It is the most. There's one thing called grace and charisma. That's another one. That's another thing. No, but and Obama, very charismatic. Very charismatic. But he's the one that deported most people, always talking about resolve. I mean, in a way. So it is not that things were not done, I think. I mean, and I'm talking from, I don't live in the United States. I'm not from here. But I think that grace is exactly the narrative that needs to be sort of put into place so that we understand that the position of somebody in he or she is a position that will definitely cause and spread out this this action of grace in a way. I come from a country that's deeply hurt right now, and we're working out. I mean, we definitely need that this narrative of of grace to come together and unite in a benevolent way with benevolent actions. With compassion, and also with a lot of valor as well, because nowadays, according to the narrative that's been established, to be graceful is to be radical. I think to do goodwill is a radical thing. To care for the other is radical. So it is, and that is an action. That is an inherent action. Is what motivates things to be done. Goodwill.
I'd love to be graceful, to be radical. That's a wonderful takeaway.
I'm going to take a few steps this way. I'm sorry.
Whoa! Cool. Exactly as it should be. Okay, we're going to mix it up. Now we're going to do what calls a lightning round. So this round, you're going to move very quickly. There's not going to be any conversation, probably. But three in a row, very quick movement. Lightning round one. I am more like Twitter, New York Review of Books. I love watching my boss, Carrie, move on this one. She used to go to Twitter. I know. Twitter, New York Review of Books. Look at, are you really like just in the center?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, lightning round number two. I hate you. Never a good response has its place. I hate you. Never a good response has its place. Wow. Wow. I just have to ask people on this side, because I'm totally on this side. Oh, I shouldn't say where I am. Why I hate you has its place. Can someone just say why I hate you has its place? Yes, in the back.
Can't help it. Oftentimes, when a person doesn't have the power or permission to speak, but like a child doesn't always have the greatest permission. The child doesn't have the permission to speak when you watch a child developmentally growing up. Facing their parents, which is a huge and omnipresent power. And the biggest thing they can say is, I hate you, to establish turf space, a place for them to be.
Cool. Would anyone also say the I hate you? I think the child analogy is such an important one, having raised one. But if we're parents. But what about as an adult? I hate you has its place. Yeah. Yeah, right there.
I think you have a right to say whatever you want at any point. And if I feel like I hate you, I'm going to tell you I hate you. Maybe you were being mean that day, and I want to express my feelings, and I have a right to feelings, and I hate you is okay sometimes.
Is there anyone in the room you'd like to share this with now?
I kind of felt like it was that toward me, but okay.
No.
Anna, do you want to add to that?
I guess I say it with the caveat that I think of saying I hate you with love. So in a relationship that where there's trust, like saying I hate you right now sort of is a good signal, sort of along these lines about children. Like I need to announce that there's something that's bothering me here, and this is the shortest way I can say it. I think as an adult, I don't think it has a place in the way I think that we think of that word and that phrase being used and thrown about and hurled at people in our culture today. So I was responding more from like thinking about fights I've had with my husband being like, I hate you right now, and it being really useful way to open a conversation.
And I take things so literal because, you know, I started speaking English when I was 14 or something. So I hate you, is it only, I mean, when you grow up in an English speaking, no? Like, semantic. It's only a thing you say to people you love, right? You would never say to a person that you really hate, I hate you. No, you would say something else like fuck off or something, no?
Oh, well, yeah, that may be
true. That's true.
But I think I hate you has a place.
There has to be something there to...
There has to be some like a relationship, and everybody's been talking about relationships actually, like people that have a close relationship. That's why I was thinking, okay, maybe it's not a good response to someone that you love. I mean, of course, because I mean, if somebody you really, really, really hate, you wouldn't say I hate you. I like to a policeman, I hate you. I don't know. Like, would you say that? I don't know. Like, I would never say that.
The reason I actually thought of this is because the word has come up so much lately. You know, there's a lot of hatred right now. I feel a lot of hate sometimes, not toward a person I know in my personal life, but sort of in the ethers. And that word hadn't really been in my vocabulary recently. And now I feel like it's sort of come up. Okay, last lightning round. I'll show you two images, and I want you to tell me, move to where, which image inspires more empathy? Which image inspires more empathy? More empathy. Ah. So this is, of course, Sally Field, former board member at Sundance, Norma Rae. And this is after one of the debates. Wow, get a picture, guys, get a picture. Oh, okay. Any changes? More empathy. So I guess the question I want to ask to Gael and Anand is, why does this one not inspire, I mean, you're way over there, empathy in your minds?
It's the presence of a monster on the left. If you look at the left half of the screen, my empathy machine breaks every time I see that Cheeto.
But it's a handshake is what I'm actually getting at. It's not a picture of just him. It's a picture of a handshake between two opposites. It's a picture of Donald Trump shaking hands.
It looks like they hate each other. She tried to avoid that particular handshake. He forced her into it. It inspires. It doesn't inspire me in any way, and it certainly does not inspire empathy.
Okay, I need to hear someone on this side then. Why does this photograph of these two people, adversaries, shaking hands, inspire empathy in you more than Norma Rae?
For me, it's what's going on right now. And I feel that empathy is now, and this is a representation of what's going on. And as much as we may think about hating people who may come from his side or his supporters, I think if we are not thinking about taking the grace of the Hillary Clinton, like if we're not like tapping into our like inner whoo sometimes, to like be seeing what it's like for the other person so that we can try to bridge the gaps for people who are willing to do that, then I think we might as well all just move to the Caribbean.
Caribbean, sounds cool.
Yeah.
Sounds amazing.
Okay, good. Okay, everyone come back to the center. This one's gonna be harder. I refuse to engage empathetically when I encounter willful ignorance, unmitigated greed. I refuse to engage empathetically when I encounter willful ignorance, unmitigated greed. Willful ignorance. Try to stay out of the middle. This is a tough one, I know, but if you had to bring the gate down, what of these two would make you bring the gate down? Greed or willfully being ignorant? Okay, so unmitigated greed. Both these guys here. Anand, why not willful ignorance?
I'm thinking, because I can't escape it, of just America right now in the moment we're in. And I think we have both of these problems, and they're both actually, to me, maybe two of the major explanatory factors behind why this happened. I think if there's a difference, and I'm not so far from the middle, it's that there's a power difference between those two. Both are sins. Both are kind of socio-political sins. But that often is a sin of people who don't have power. And not always, but I think right now that's, and it's a way of, it's an acting out when you don't feel, and it's true that they don't have power. It's true that money corrupts politics. It's true that voice has been taken away. And sometimes that is a way that you cope and you fight back. This, to me, feels like people with power just trying to get more power. And it feels less defensible.
Gail?
Yeah, I had to think about it, of course, because I was like, okay, why choose? you know, like, yeah. But when you mentioned, like, okay, try to not stay in the center, yeah, I think it's very similar, the response of thinking that willful ignorance is a way that you can work in tangents around, I guess. You can ignore as a form of empathy as well. Certain things, you know, like, okay, let that pass. You know, okay, woo,
yes.
You know.
Yes.
But that, I mean, it greed, unlimited greed in that sense, or unmitigated greed, is certainly something that at the end you have to definitely engage and confront, and with here's where empathy becomes, okay, well, I have to choose a side in this discussion. I have right. to definitely be on like, say, this is the line. This is it. Like, there's no, I'm gonna stop the empathy.
So it feels like people sort of interpreted this willful ignorance as a class of, let's say, Americans now who were not afforded certain opportunities. But I'm thinking of very, very privileged people, extremely privileged people who actually do know right from wrong and willfully decide to go against what is truth. Does that change anyone's mind? This is not people who our own government, through both administrations, has forgotten, has not properly educated, that no money's gone into education. These are people who have had every possible opportunity.
But to me, they're not ignorant. There's another problem there that you're naming. They're not ignorant. Like, I think there's a difference between the person whose willful ignorance takes the form of not reading the paper, and therefore
right.
they actually don't know, and they've chosen to be ignorant, which
right.
is what I take from that, versus the people you're talking about who do know and still act another way, which to me feels more like this.
Like this, okay.
What's
that?
And it's refuse to engage. So even though you can say, which one are you going to refuse to engage with?
Right, right.
You
know, that's right. That's right. That's right.
I will
that's
engage
right.
with them. This is the creepy ones.
Okay.
The creepy ones.
Oh, someone from the couch has a statement. Yes. Someone with their leg in a cast. Sundance.
Hello. I'm squarely in the middle, and that's because I think that their actual willful ignorance is greed. I think they're kind of the same thing, or one leads to the other, because you're kind of greedy for contentment and happiness at the expense of others, and you can't, yeah. So I think this is one where you really, truly can be in the middle, because I just don't see, I won't engage with either of them.
Okay, so taking it from there, progress is most effectively achieved through compassionate empathy, righteous indignation. Progress is most effectively achieved through compassionate empathy, righteous indignation. Really? Wow. Wow. All such sweet people. Okay, so I want to start here. Righteous indignation, how does that move us toward progress? And what are examples, maybe?
Talk. Do one of y'all want to talk?
Anyone?
For me, I feel like it's something that kind of goes down the line if you let it kind of pass, and so that's why you need righteous indignation. Something that happened this morning on the way here was I stopped at McDonald's for breakfast, and a woman cut me off. I mean, there was like five people behind me, but she cut off in line to get in front of me, and she ended up, like, while driving more, she, like, scratched my car. And so if I had, and it's a rental car, so it's kind of okay. But it's kind of okay. But if I had stepped up and said something, like, she gave me the hand, like, no, you're going to stop. I'm going to go. If I had said, like, no, don't go by, then, you know, that wouldn't happen. So I feel like it's like a domino effect, you know? I think you need to stop things when it kind of happens. And I mean, compassion, empathy is all well, but I have a scratched car, so you know, I have to deal with that.
Okay, and so, but thinking about progress again, you know, and actually thinking maybe historically about progress or even personal progress, everyone here is sort of saying that progress really is more effectively achieved through empathy as opposed to Gail?
I mean, I'm actually here in the middle, like right.
But
the
right
middle.
On this side.
Right in the middle, and
that's
maybe
a cool
this
place
side.
To be.
Yeah, exactly. Yes, because this is, in a way, everyone's projecting here, no? Like we're all projecting, like our. But I think that that.
We're gonna do a real version with no lights. Exactly. We'll see what
I think that in a way, compassionate empathy is something that is. Let's say that I carry, or I try to make it into a kind of, like always do the process of that. But the indignation is the point of is the line that you draw, or is the point of refusal to, let's say, with the words of Salvador Allende, just to mention. I mean, he says basically. The people should not be sacrificed, but people should not also be humiliated. You know, we shouldn't sacrifice ourselves to die martyrs, but we should not let ourselves be humiliated. So I think it is exactly that kind of middle ground of the indignation is the calling as well to stop certain things from happening and stopping them like altogether. I mean, on a very personal way, for example, when I stopped eating meat, for example, red meat, it came from I knew all that. I knew the fact that it's the worst thing that can happen to ecology. It's like all of that. But it had to come from a point of like, okay, this is gonna be my posture, and it came from an anger mm-hmm. side. It came from a kind of like, okay, I'm gonna draw the line and I'm gonna do it for myself and for humanity in a way, and I had to appeal to this feeling.
Anand, as you answer, I'm curious, what is it about righteous indignation that feels dangerous to you?
I mean, I'm very close to the center, and I would say two things. First of all, I think these two things, unlike some of the other spectrums, are actually wonderful collaborators. And when I think about history and the story of progress, I think either of these engines on its own would crash the plane, and it's how they work together. But I think 80% of the I would say it this way, that I think there's a kind of cyclical nature. And at most normal moments, this is helpful. You don't have a society if you don't have compassion, empathy at some measure. And you don't have local PTAs and civic, what is all that for? What Tocqueville came to America? Like, if people are not associating with their hearts in simple ways, at low levels all the time, figuring out each other and binding themselves to each other, you don't really have a society. But I think every now and then, you get to a moment where something needs to be shaken up. Some people need to be dislodged from a position of power or something that they're grabbing hold of, and you need that. If you look at even getting over slavery, it was an interesting mix of these two things, right? Harriet Beecher Stowe wrote her book, and that had a very big impact on rallying people who already sort of agreed and winning over some people who didn't. But then you also had to fight a war at some point. Right. And I don't think either of those things on its own would have solved it.
Is there a sense right now? Oh, yeah, Michelle.
I mean, I live over there. I lead through always, thinking about the high road as a place where my heart lies. But I really think it's about this particular moment. I'm not far to the left right now, but I do believe we all have to ask ourselves, what do we stand for right now? What is the world that we want to live in? And I think it's going to take more righteous indignation right now. I don't leave that behind because that's who I am, but I feel we have to be vigilant right now, and we have to be very clear about imagining the future that we want it to be. So I'm here, and I feel like I'm standing tall here right now.
Oh, nice. Can I just add one thing that I think I understand for the runway and the physical dynamics, we have to have it like this. But I think within righteous indignation, there's an empathetic varietal
course,
and an unempathetic. So if you think about Bernie Sanders and Trump, they actually had a similar diagnosis, that there's a cabal of people who run too many things, that certain people have been shafted for too long for generations, the same forces shafted them. I think Bernie's was motivated by some fellow feeling for those people, and I think Trump's was an exploitative, you know, abuse of those people while trying to channel their anger.
Exactly. Yeah, which is exactly why this is a creative tension that's dynamic, right? And it's also going back to Chinese medicine, within every yang, the most yang is the seat of yin, and within the seat of yin, within the yang, yinist most is the seat of yang, right? So it's sort of what this is dynamically about. I'm gonna speed this up because I know we have a few minutes left. I'm gonna do one more lightning round, but I'm actually not gonna stop and say, why did you choose it? Here we go. Is this the one that, can I articulate this about, this is, okay. If I were asked to take in a close friend or relative to my home, I would feel welcoming, wary. If I was asked to take in a close friend or relative, I would feel welcoming, wary. If I were asked to take in a neighbor, I would feel welcoming, wary. If I were asked to take in a neighbor, I would feel welcoming, wary. And finally, if I were asked to take in a Syrian refugee, I would feel welcoming, wary. Huh. So much for neighbors. Okay. Two more. I'm gonna give you an image. I'm gonna skip to the image, Christopher. This is an image, and I'm gonna ask you, once we get to this, oh, there's the image. Okay, the image is behind me. Okay, this image mortally offends me, shatters my heart. This image mortally offends me, shatters my heart. These are not turning out the way I imagined. This is fascinating. Okay, so where are our, Gael is there, and you're way over. So Anand, why are you over to Shatters Your Heart? And what does that mean to you?
One way to think about it is if there's a reverse version of that image that would shatter my heart. And I think if I'm logically consistent, they should shatter my heart equally.
But it's not, it's this one.
I think people are, whenever you meet them, better than the way they vote, better than the comments they leave on Twitter. I grew up in a part of the country that's in dumb fuckistan right now, which may explain my own dumb fuckiness or something. But I know those people. They're a lot nicer than the people I live with now in New York. But they voted for, many of them probably voted for Trump. And I think we have to, I take a very radical, and this is, your joke about following the tweets. I take a very radical view on what's right and wrong here. So I'm not wishy-washy on that. And I'm very strong on this person being a monster and this being the most dangerous moment maybe in American history. But those are my people. And I think if you cannot separate those two things, my people may have voted to do a wrong thing. I think my people, by the way, have voted to do a lot of wrong things to those people over the years that we haven't owned up to. And so I just think you have to be very, very fierce about your values, but never write off your fellow citizens.
I'm in the center. Yeah, I'm in the center. And first of all, both are kind of negative feelings, no? When watching this, so it is kind of and very similar in a way. But I must say, I see this image and I laugh about it, really, because it's a funny kind of division. The way that whenever I see America just. And this is something from my perspective of somewhere from outside of the United States, but I am an American, I am from this continent. So whenever I see the word America only used to mention the United States, I go like, You know, like, it's not, I'm American also, you know? I mean, in our world, Spanish-speaking, we call ourselves Americans, you know? Like, when a Spanish person says, oh, you're American, you know, I am an American. And I think I also, I mean, it is a beautiful sort of encouraging and inspiring word for me, America. You know, it is a place where the whole world met for the first time. China, I mean, Asia, Africa, Europe, America went together in this encounter, no? in this word. So it is something that I strongly feel if America has the positive connotation in that sense, I support it. You know, I support the fact that it's like, so I don't, I'm not bothered by this image, to be honest, because at the same time, I'm angered by the fact that many people voted for this guy.
Okay, we're gonna do one more, but before we do, just because there are some folks on this side, I'd love to know about your mortally offendedness of this.
Given two choices between having your heart break, no action, and being mortally offended, I feel like as an American, you know, we're all here in Park City, there's lots of natives here. These people aren't fucking dumb fucks, right? We like these people. These are the people who might have voted for Trump or might not have. But these are people who voted out of fear, who maybe voted out of ignorance or bad information. So when this happens, it's like my choice is between, oh, I'm so sad, my heart is broken, or like, fuck you, dude. Like, seriously, like, don't save my whole country and everyone. And like, this is Park City. This is like all these places that we love and the rest of our America. We have friends there. Like, screw you. Like, this is not like what we are. And like, I don't want to be some passivist, empathetic person that says, oh, so fucking sad, someone said that. Like, I'm gonna say, no, fuck you.
Anybody else moving? Okay, good, thank you. Cool. All right, this is our last one. We have to wrap this up. The end game of empathy, come to the center. The end game of empathy must be acceptance, activism. The end game of empathy must be acceptance. The end game, activism. Okay, let's talk to folks that are on the acceptance and what that means to people. The end game, yep.
Maybe this is just my understanding of activism, but I've always taken that as a means to reach acceptance. I mean, like the Women's March just on Saturday felt like it was, you know, this women got really shafted with the way we are right now. And so it's an activism to make that voice heard and so that they are accepted in the world. Whereas socially conscious films are about accepting people who are often marginalized. So yeah, I see that as a means to an end to this end game vocab words.
Okay, cool. Anyone have a counter argument to that or a counter idea? Yeah.
I believe very strongly in kind of the concept of otherness, and I think that acceptance, you know, is never enough. And once you accept one population, there will be others who will try and kind of tear that down because they don't understand that. So, you know, constantly the end goal of empathy has to be activism. It doesn't have to be violent, but it's, you know, that vigilance, you know, as an empathetic being.
Cool. Anon?
You know, I mean, I was reflecting this week going to movies, and I only went to the ones I went to, but it actually seems to me that a crowd like ours watching movies like this does pretty great on this. I think we watch movies about Ferguson, and we are like, totally. Black lives totally matter, totally. And I don't think it does anything. I think we've all read that for 40 years, the median income hasn't gone up. 117 million Americans, on average, have not gotten a raise since 1980 or whatever. I think we know that. We read it. We read the life expectancy is going down. We read it. I don't think it does anything. So I don't think activism is only protest, but I would define it as like if it's the political life, if it's saying my acceptance compels something, I'm willing to maybe give up something. If rich white people who watch the Ferguson movie don't just say, those lives totally matter, but I'm willing for my child, I'm willing for public school funding to be centralized and equalized, and I'm willing for my child in Westchester County to go to a worse school, for those kids to go to a better school, That's what I feel doesn't happen, and that's kind of what I feel the only thing that matters.
Okay, we'll end with Gail.
I think that empathy is such a is such an active feeling, an innate kind of feeling that when you see little kids, starting to accept the other, you know, or let's say to engage with the other. Well, what happens with this empathetic notion is that they start to do things together. And it is our biological kind of, I don't want to sustain it with facts or anything, but it is.
There's no such thing anymore.
Maybe some alternative facts that I'll just come up with right now. But it is a feeling that causes curiosity, that causes is what has made humanity be here. You know, it's what made us survive. In a way, this empathy that sparks all these other notions and that makes us do things. That's why, just to place it into a kind of very palpable thing. I mean, we're criminalizing workers, migrant workers, all over the world right now, no? And I believe most of us here might be migrant workers. I mean, we work in different places. We've been in different places. We work all around, and some of us have the fortunate position to be in that we are able to do it with documents and on a legal sort of way, no? Which is quite hard because the bureaucracy of it's really complicated. But we're criminalizing that in such a way that we are killing the most beautiful kind of journey that humanity has ever done, is to go to another place to make things better, not only for you, but for the people that are there. And that is something that is definitely not not put into practice right now, not into the conversation. On the contrary, it's meant to be something that from the get-go is wrong. And the economy, socially, biologically, environmentally, the world needs this coming and going from place to place, because the money does it, but people are not doing it on a legal way, you know? And we should definitely strive to find that way. I mean, take it into that, but I think it is a very palpable thing of empathy and activism to engage and to put things together so that we can pursue that curiosity that you want all the other kids to have, to be able to have that chance.
Can I just say, in the week when our country has treated so degradingly the country you come from, I'm happy we're having this conversation, and I'm sorry that, but it's not he's not all of us.
Oh, on that note, we've run over time, so we have to stop. I want to first of all thank Anand and Gail for being our protagonists.
You know, Gail's going to be 20% more expensive very soon
to bring him here.
So I know. It's very good that you got him now.
Yeah, I know. It was purposeful. Yeah. I also want to thank everybody here for being, you know, a participant in this. I want to thank Sundance and IDEO, and thank you for letting me be your moderator. Have a great day and re-enter the world. Thanks so much. Thank you.